So hi, hello, wanakam, and a very good morning, people. It's great to have you all here with us. And I see the count is escalating as we speak. And I hope you can call up or text your other friends and ask them to join, because we are going to start real soon. So can we wait like for a couple of minutes for the count to rise? Or should we get started right away? So?
Probably we can start.
Okay, great. Okay. So nothing has such power to broaden the mind as the ability to investigate systematically and truly all that comes under the observation in life, from the words of Marcus Aurelius. A wonderful and pleasant morning and a very warm welcome to one and all present here. This is Harshika representing the student community of Chennai Institute of Technology, extending a very warm welcome to our invited eminent speakers and all of your students to this session of Day 5 of Chennai Institute of Technology's Career Corpus 4.0 on behalf of our beloved chairman, secretary ma'am, principal sir, faculties and students. When the world went all virtual, we here at Chennai Institute of Technology took that to our advantage with constant motivation for growth for both career and interpersonal skills through various webinar lectures, panel discussions, debates, workshops, hackathons and innovative challenges to check all boxes and give students an all-round holistic development. We have our non-technical national level symposiums and techno-cultural fest, Takshashila. What makes us stand out to the crowd is that our events are fully coordinated and organized by our students. Today, we have gathered virtually for the finest of our signature events, Career Compass 4.0, a one-stop shop for turning all your dreams into reality. And through the years, through the span of 5 days, this is day five, right? So we had about 30 speakers speaking for the past 4 days on various topics like IT products, crafting the future, about blooming technologies like cloud computing, AI, ML, DS, and IT services. We do aspire a session specially dedicated to women and their challenges. And then we had innovation and startup, entrepreneurship, engineering services, higher education, which happened till yesterday. And today, here we are gathered for research as a career. So in the fourth iteration of this industry institute conclave, we have a digital synchrony of knowledge and experience to redefine our future through the guidance of various business experts and professionals from renowned institutes and industries all around the globe. So research is formalized curiosity. It's poking and prying with a purpose, says Soren Yin. Research is to see what everybody else has seen and to think what nobody else has thought. But there are so many career options out there for engineering graduates, which we have seen in the previous sessions. You sure would know research plays a major role. As they say, research is creating knowledge. And we here at Chennai Institute of Technology, and that's why we have a session dedicated to national and international research and its opportunities in our flagship event, Career Corpus 4.0, named Research as a Career. So apart from all this, visual representation is the best form of representation, I believe. So here's a visual treat to walk us through Career Corpus 4.0. Just a second, there seems to be a technical glitch. And here it is. Thank you.
It's a great name you have to call it compass, because a compass is not like a map. A compass is beautiful in the sense that it tells you where you are, it tells you where you have to point yourself, but lets you chart your own path. And that's the greatest gift we can give to the next generation of students coming in to organizations like this.
Career Compass is the place that I actually got idea about my future from the real estate
Compass is a very good initiative by this organization, bringing experts from all the different fields, exposing the students to all possible rates of employment that they can pick up. It's a very good effort.
It's an eye-opener for students who only are bound to study, but I think there's a world beyond their studies, and I think this insights is definitely will help them to gauge and understand.
Career Compass is a colossal opportunity. It actually gives you an insight about different problems like research, core engineering, IT, and so on.
The whole idea behind a Career Compass is to show the different types of opportunity that exist for the students when they come out of the final year. It could be either in the IT services or the core industry, or it could be in the public sector, and it could be even the higher education some of the students would like to.
I think it gave me a better clarity on how to pursue my future.
Some interesting questions I found was breaking the mold. It need not be that just because you have gone through an engineering education, you need to end up as an engineer. Right? It was impressive to see a couple of CIT students becoming an actress, becoming an RG, assuming its mission of helping students navigate through the ocean of career that they are getting.
I recommend Career Compass for all these students.
I'm very eager to interact with the industrial experts.
That was some video, wasn't it? It was a feast for eyes and it walked us through what Career Compass was throughout the years. And I see that Professor Chin Pavli has joined us. Professor, if you could turn on your camera. It's the first button on top. And I think you've muted yourself. Professor, can you hear us? Okay, so I think we'll go on with the schedule.
Yeah.
So with immense pleasure and pride, I request Dr. Karthikeyan Rajagopal, Senior Researcher, Center of Nonlinear Systems, Chennai Institute of Technology, to address and welcome today's virtual gathering. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Ashika. And Dr. Lee, welcome. And it is my pleasure to welcome all the participants for the session on research as a career, which is a part of Career Compass Day 5. I welcome all the eminent speakers, Dr. Milind Mahajan from Space Center Ahmedabad, Dr. Gaurav Rao from Naval Material Research Laboratory, Professor Chun Bai Ali from Nanjing University of Information Science and Technology, China, and Shri Jitu Mohan from Siemens Research Center. Welcome you all, sir. And to give you a glimpse of what CIT has done in the research perspective, let me just put some data, statistics, for you. We have established 9 core research centers exclusively specialized on areas like nonlinear systems, system design, applied research, nanotechnology, energy research, computational biology, communication and networks, and artificial intelligence. And this year, that is in the assessed 2020, we have increased our publications 5 times compared to our 2019 publications. Saying so, we have also increased our citations 7 times compared to 2019 data. Apart from this, we are now concentrated on international collaborations. Even Professor Lee is one of our close collaborator. We have collaborators from Oxford University. We have collaborators from San Diego State. We are now establishing a joint research center with Defense University of Ethiopia. We are now trying one from Oxford University Center for Statistics and Mechanics. And we are also working closely with some of the eminent institutes of India like IIT Madras, IIT Kharagpur, and IIT Mumbai. Apart from this, we are now specially focused on establishing research incubation centers where we are focused mainly towards amalgamating industry experts like you and student researchers from our campus to have joint papers, joint research proposals to various public sector industries. To further proceed on this, we hope that this session will help the students to better understand what are the research perspectives in international arena where Dr. Leave is an expert, and about the defense research where our friend Dr. Milind Mahajan will throw some light, and about the naval material research and other naval perspectives, our friend Dr. Gaurav Rao will put some idea. And finally, the research on industrial sector, the future research. An apt speaker from Siemens Research, he's also a lead researcher in the future technologies. So, welcome you all, sir. And I'll request again Arshika to give a brief introduction about our eminent speakers. Thank you, Arshika.
Sure, sir. With pleasure. So, moving on. Today's session is dedicated solely to research and the plethora of opportunities that await us out there. Experience is the teacher of all things, they say. So, we have here with us splendid speakers to enlighten us and blow our minds. And let me give a brief introduction about them to you. And first up, we have Dr. Gaurav Rao, Dr. A. Gaurav Rao, Project Director and Scientist in Naval Material Services, a research laboratory, DRDO, is doctorate from IIT Bombay, Department of Metallurgical Engineering and Material Science. The area of interest and expertise are in development, friction, stir welding, and processing or defense application, structure property characterization using advanced microscopy and material characterization techniques like SEM, EBSD, SEMTKD, and so on. Fatigue and fracture toughness, evaluation of materials, completed failure investigation studies of more than 50 naval and defense components. Also entrusted an important role as technical staff officer to Director NMRL. He has published more than 40 international papers in peer-reviewed international journal and also having two international patents in his credits. So consulting while also being updated with the blooming technologies as well. So we are privileged to have you here with us. Welcome, sir. And next
thank
up.
Thank you so much for the introduction.
Yes, sir. Our pleasure. And next up, we have Dr. Milind Mahajan, who obtained his BE electronics degree in 1991 from Maharvada University, Aurangabad, an MTech degree in microwave engineering from IIT BHU Varanasi in 1993. He received his PhD degree from DD University, Nadiad, in 2015. He started his career in spacecraft payload group of Space Application Center, Ahmedabad, from 1993. He is currently working as the group director of Antenna Systems Group, and he worked as guest scientist at German Aerospace Center, DLR, in 2001. He's been the designer of shaped reflectors and dual gridded reflector antennas, high power helix antenna, multiple beam antennas for the various INSAT and GSAT programs. His current areas of interest are contoured beam reflector antennas and digital beam forming based antennas. He held many responsibilities as deputy project director for payload antenna systems of INSAT 4A, 4B, 4C and GSAT 55P. And many more other satellites and radars. So he is the recipient of Space Gold Medal of Astronomical Society of India in 2005. ISRO's Team Excellence Awards in 2007, 2008, 2015, and 2017. He has more than 50 publications in national, international journals and conferences and 3 national and international patents to his credit. It is our immense pleasure to have you with us, sir. Welcome.
Thank you. Thank you, Ashita, for a nice introduction.
Yes, sir. It is our pleasure to have you here. And next up, we have Professor Junbao Lee, who was born in Yangzhou, China in 1971, and he is currently a professor in the School of Artificial Intelligence at Nanjing University of Information Science and Technology. He received his master's degree and PhD degree from Nanjing University of Science and Technology in succession in 2004 and 2009. From 2010 to 2014, he was a postdoctoral fellow in School of Information Science and Engineering at Southeast University. He has been a visiting scholar in the Department of Physics at the University of Wisconsin-Madison in 2012 and 2013. His research interests are in the areas of nonlinear dynamics and chaos, including nonlinear circuits, meristematic systems, and corresponding applications. So he has been devoted to finding the multi-stability mechanism in dynamic systems and the methodology for constructing chaotic systems with amplitude control and offset boosting. So he has received several awards for his teaching and research in Jiangsu province, and he has been awarded one of the most cited Chinese researchers for exceptional research performance in the field of information and communication engineering according to Elsevier's Analytics in 2020. So he has bagged about 5 patents, and we are thrilled to have you here. Welcome, sir. I think you muted yourself, sir.
Dr. Lee, please unmute.
Okay, thanks. Perfect, sir.
Thank you.
Welcome to Science Student Technology.
Okay.
So moving on, last but not the least, we have with us Dr. Sri Jitu Mohan, who is a design thinker and passionate engineer who loves building solutions which make products and services intelligent. He has expertise in interdisciplinary research fields like predictive modeling, industrial AI, and product engineering. Sri Jitu Mohan is working as a researcher in the field of intelligent machines with a decade-long cutting-edge research experience. He is currently working as lead research engineer at Siemens Corporate Technology and Research. His research focus is on explainable AI for manufacturing, tribal physical production systems. Prior to joining Siemens, he worked with Bosch in the technology and innovation division. He also holds an honorable position as industrialist in the board of governors at College of Engineering, Trikapur, a government of Kerala undertaking. So he is also an honorary member of the Industrial Advisory Board, Computer Applications Department at MSRIT Bangalore. Sri Jitu Mohan completed his master's in mechatronic engineering from National Institute of Technology, Karnataka, and graduation in electronics and communication from University of Kerala. He also involved himself in driving Bosch International Open Source Center of Excellence Machine Learning Community Initiatives at this organization. And he has filed 4 patents as part of the research journey. It is truly an honor to have you with us. Welcome, sir.
Thank you very much for the introduction. And I'm honored to be part of this panel discussion with the eminent members from the industry and academia here. Thank you.
Pleasure is asked to have, sir. And finally, last but not the least, we have with us to play today's moderator, Dr. Karthikeyan Rajagopal, Senior Researcher, Center of Nonlinear Systems, Chennai Institute of Technology. And I request you to take over and kickstart today's session, sir.
Thank you, Arshika. Let me take over. Thank you, speakers. And let's start the session with Dr. Milind Mahajan, Group Science, Group Director, Antenna Systems Group, Space Application Center, ISRO. I welcome you, Doctor, for the
thank you
presentation.
So, shall I share my screen?
Yes, sir. You are. All is yours.
Okay. Is my screen is visible?
Perfect, sir. Just you have to present it.
Presentation. Okay. Good morning, all dignitaries and international and national experts and principal and faculty members from CIT and my dear students. It's really my great pleasure to have an interaction with you especially the research as a career. When I was introduced, I was asked that we have to give just interact with the students on the research, especially. That gave me immense pleasure that really the institutes are working and feeding the ideas of research from the graduate student. That's a very welcome move from the institute, and really I appreciate that. And students are showing the interest in research. That itself is really motivating and encouraging things as an Indian and research from the different government organization. This is certainly required initiatives from the various institute which can take up our all the talents in India, can take it to the further height also in building the nations and making at par with the international community. So once again, good morning all. I'm giving a very briefly on research as a career in ISRO. I'm just giving a touching, just a brief, very briefly touching what the ISRO is doing and how it is providing the a very friendly environment for the conducting a research and make it really a target oriented. In case anybody asks the question, they can interrupt me and the ask the questions. Okay, starting with the what are the ISRO? You may be aware of the ISRO's endeavors in the recent past and present scenario. We have, as ISRO, Indian Space Organization, we have different types of satellite portfolios with us. They are geostationary communication satellites, navigation satellites, like we do have our own Indian regional navigation satellite constellations called named as NAVIC, and in which we have various fleet of satellites providing the navigational information competing with the other international satellite scenario like GPS, GLONASS, BeiDou, and other navigational satellites. There are also Earth observation satellites which are having either optical remote sensing or microwave remote sensing satellites, which are essential for providing the various applications in terms of the either crop monitoring, forestry, or in.
Dr. Milan,
yeah, please.
Sir, your slide is not moving for us because you have to share the entire screen. You can stop sharing, and when you are sharing.
What is the slide you are saying now?
I am on the first slide, research as a career.
Oh.
You have to share full screen, the entire screen. Select the option entire screen.
Okay, I will do that again.
Yeah, sir. Perfect. You can now press it.
Yeah, is it now visible?
Yes, sir. Perfect.
Yeah. So I was referring these geostationary communication satellite, navigation satellite, Earth observation satellites, and we do have recent past last few years we have some planetary observation satellites like Chandrayaan 2, Chandrayaan 1 orbiters, Mars mission orbiters, and many more which are in pipeline. And apart from that, we do have a human space program which is yet to be floor. These are a few examples which are shown, which are under GSAT-6, our high power multimedia satellite, which is undergoing tests, which are showing another one satellite of INSAT-4A, which is undergoing tests, which are showing just a depiction of these satellites. We do have various launchers. We do have various capabilities in small satellite launch vehicle in polar orbits, geostationary orbit, that PSLV, GSLV Mark III, which are having able to lift off very heavy satellites and in geostationary orbits. You might have heard me earlier also probably from a few of our ISRO launch vehicle experts. I am from the domain of the satellite, so I will be just giving some few technological in the and applications in the satellite, and then in those areas are what are the opportunities. There are forthcoming programs which ISRO is working on, and Gaganyaan, that is a humans in space program, Chandrayaan 3, that is, which will be our second attempt for landing on the moon. Recently, we are geared up for getting successful landing on Chandrayaan 3 after the brief failure on landing. Though our orbiter on Chandrayaan 2 is a great success and is still able to provide the various imaging of the moon and hopefully, certainly, we are confident that our Chandrayaan 3 mission will be a successful attempt on landing on the moon. There are the Gaganyaan, which will be our ambitious project for sending a human in space with International Space Station and all. So that will be our first attempt with a very small sending a human in space for at least 3 to 4 days. So why I have brought out these topics are mainly all these different programs or different satellites really require various R&D efforts, advanced technological development program. Without that, none of the programs, whatever we had flown, would have been succeeded. We did have failures in the ground, in the development phases, and then only we could succeed successful programs in orbit, which immensely required dedicated and immense hard work during the research phase. In the advanced planning stages only we can have such kind of successful program. So there is a significant importance of the research in the making this program successful. In our navigation satellite, that is a Navi constellation, there are various applications we have shown in the various domains. I will not touch upon these. Maybe you are already aware, might be in very much in use in navigation, might be using the GPS in your mobile, but not Navi. But our efforts are that all these, our indigenously developed Navi, will come in our mobile phone also. So there are various applications we are very much into for the societal application in disaster management, vehicle tracking and fleet management. We are also trying how the oxygen tankers are moving, and despite wherever they are stuck up, that also we are tracking through this Navi. That kind of applications we have developed and implemented. So planners will know where these critical logistics are moving, and they can track and accordingly plan accordingly. Various mapping and geodetic data capture, terrestrial navigation aid, and the various other applications which are for aerial and marine navigations for these satellites are being in use. The Earth observation satellite, which I mentioned, that are the mostly for remote sensing application like Cartosat, ResourceSat, OceanSat, RSAT-2D, SAR-Alert, and SCATSAT. These are very much having the many societal applications, on the agriculture and soils, renewable energies, ocean sciences, forestry, environmental science, geology and geomorphology, water land resources, rural and urban development. There is nothing that whatever we are developing a satellite, it is for only the showcasing only the technology is never the aim of the ISRO. It is make it to the society application. That's a very fundamental base of the ISRO's program. Whatever the satellite or launches we make, it has to be used for this. That is the driving factor for all the scientists in ISRO, that whatever technology they are developing, it is put to the use of the common man. So, for example, if you take the cyclone Genesis, whatever the program satellite, we are remote sensing satellite, we are sending, those are able to use it, predict in much in advance where the cyclone and how they are generating and how the track will be, and then so that it can save the human casualty and any much more losses, and it gives a sufficient time for the planners to reduce the casualty. This is one of the typical example I told. There are many applications like in agriculture, forestry and environmental science planning. These satellites are being put to use, and that is really the driving factor for the scientists to work on the advances and the technology which can be really making the use to the common man. the applications of communication satellite, you may be well aware of, that is the DTH, point-to-point communications, and backhaul services for mobile communication, broadband data connectivity, rapid deployment for disaster management. So this has become satellite, communication satellite has become a backbone for the all various types of communication in India. So, now I will just touch upon the areas, what are the, especially in the electronics domain, computer domain, but nevertheless, it is, the whatever the ISRO programs, it is does involve all the aspects of the engineering, all the branches of engineering, all the branches of science. In fact, at least at Space Application Center, from engineer, electronics, computer, mechanical, civil, chemical engineering to really agriculturists, geologists, geophysicists, physicists, all kind of expertise are required and to carry out the research for developing these payloads, advances in payloads. So these are providing, the ISRO is providing a very good platform, very wide kind of offering, broad spectrum of areas conducting the research, like in communication payloads, monolithic microwave IC design and development, application-specific IC design and development, advanced technological optical payloads, advanced image processing, artificial intelligence and machine learning. These are just, I've listed a few. These are, so I am saying, these are whatever the advances are there, they have, they are essentially required to carry out their R&Ds and develop the technological payload and put to use for the common man. And that is really the at the base of the ISRO's fundamental principle. So I once again would like to reiterate that in all the engineering branches, they can contribute to the ISRO's research programs and contribute in the building the nation. Now I will come to the what kind of research environment ISRO is providing for the different its employees. It's the state-of-the-art infrastructure in you name it, the word of the various laboratories, various instrument, latest equipments, which are really state-of-the-art in the world. So that is making your research as competitive as international scientists are having in different laboratories, different international space agencies. So we are providing a very good infrastructure, very good facilities to carry conduct their research. And moreover, the second important point is the freedom of research. What I mean by freedom of research is the fresh graduate, if he has an idea and he would like to put up a proposal for technological demonstration or advanced R&D, he will have a free funding for that. But he will have really liberal funding in that. He has to only provide a linkage where it will fit into the program or the, any application, then there will not be a hierarchical any hurdles or any proposal, and he will have full freedom to conduct his research and for any technological demonstration program or any advanced R&D program. This is a very much important criteria and making it very healthy environment. It is giving whatever the new joinees we have come, they are very enthusiastic in conducting the research because of this freedom. And that is the one of the key factor of success in ISRO. This is, there is a freedom in research for research, even for any of the level of the employee. Another important environment which is providing successful research is the interdisciplinary experts teams available under one umbrella. So as I mentioned earlier, all types of branches are available, experts are available in one center. So that does mean that any of the research you carry out, it is not isolated. Nowadays, none of the technology is only one field. But I cannot say I am the electronics engineer, I don't need a mechanical engineer, I don't need any other physical physics expert or anything, because or chemical expert. Any of the hardware we develop, it does require, I need a mechanical and structural engineering support. Whatever the electronic design I carry out, it has to be sustained in a very harsh environment in space, it like a minus 100 to plus 130 degrees Celsius. So that kind of very harsh environment it has to sustain. It needs some expertise from the mechanical background, it needs mechanical experts from the thermal expert, chemical expert and all. So when you make any design or products, carry out research, you need to interact with the different team. So that is the interdisciplinary expert teams availability under one umbrella. That is a very positive environment which is providing to the all the employees. The funding availability I mentioned, the funding, liberally funds are released for the conducting the research and technological development programs. The another for conducting the research, in-service higher education opportunities, IITs, ISCs, various international conferences, so that you're interacting with the international experts, so which can broaden your horizon for while conducting your research. You have various opportunity for patents and publications. And the most important thing is that it is not the open-ended research we do career. We have to be time-bound. We have to be result-oriented. So that is the target-oriented research, ensuring the pace and its success. We are continuously followed up. They are continuously monitored. It's not that we are giving the research and nobody is watching. It is the continuous monitoring and the target orientation of the any of the research program that is making its success and ultimately put to use in the any onboard programs. Now, if I ask you what are to make the career in ISRO, what are the different ways to enter ISRO? If I see at a graduation level, at the entry level for the post of scientific engineer SC, which is the class one gazetted officer as far as Government of India is concerned, and it is via a ISRO centralized recruitment board which conducts annually an entrance test over in completely India at different places, which is online test. Because nowadays due to this, and it can be also in a normal ways, it is a written test in person. After the entrance test, it is there is a screening and the filtering, and then it means candidates are called for the personal interview. And in that after personal interview, then the filtering is made and selections are carried out for the scientist engineer SC. This is after graduation. There is another way to enter in ISRO is after post graduation at the post of SC. Though it is a post, but the next promotion will be within 2 years, once you join after the post-graduation, like MTech or ME, there is no written test, but only the qualification, depending on the specialization in the your MTech or ME, and then there is a screening because applications are invited from the all over India, and then there is a direct interview. This is relatively comparatively easier option by entering in the after post-graduation compared to the option one, but the number of posts are very less compared to the in option one, where the number of posts released per year are quite enormous. There is another way after PhD, the entry level entry at the post of scientist engineer SD, that is by personal interview. Here, the ISRO website is open to register the PhD students and put up the continuously. It is continuously on that process. They interested PhD students can register their biodata and the research topics, and then the ISRO normally screens regularly interval. If they find any suitable candidate, and they call for the personal interview for the their own requirement. I would like to give a tip. I was a few times a member of the ICRB board. What we see in the candidate during the interview is not the advances in the technology. What we see, check the candidates is its fundamental. How strong are its fundamentals and how the clarity of the concept, whatever he learns in the base is graduation. So because we know the ones, the fundamentals and the concepts are clear, the any candidate can take challenge of any advances. So it is not that when entering ISRO, you have to read the advances in the technology. No, it is absolutely reverse way. We check only the fundamentals. Whatever you study in the basic in your graduation, those only we check for. How clearly he has absorbed the fundamental concept and how clearly he explained, that is what we look forward from the personal interview. After screening the written test, we know that he has a concept, he can very well explain the fundamental. If the question is twisted, then how he faced that fundamental question, that is what we test only in the interview. Now, the career progress in ISRO, if we see, there are really a time-bound promotions. They are not vacancy dependent. And all the promotions, the only thing is that to make the quality continues, keep the quality of the employee, the every promotion is with performance assessed with assessment review. So assessment, that is every assessment, there will be interview and promotions are given, but they are really a time bound. There is no vacancy. It's not that no, there is a vacancy, the promotion will not be there. It is not there. So there will be a continuous promotion, but only at every performance, every stage change, there will be a performance assessment here. What is the important in the research? Ultimately, just one line, I will end up my talk with this, is the passion. Your passion for the research and passion and continuous pursuit, because there may be failures, but still you pursue and believe in yourself. Yes, this will, I will make it success, and your hard work, that will is the key for success in research, and that we certainly look for in this. Thank you. Thank you very much. So with this, I conclude my talk.
Thank you, Dr. Milan. It was indeed a great speech, and you have not covered only the technology aspects. You have also given the tips to students on how to, or what are the areas they should concentrate. Hope the students will post the questions soon, because the question answer session is organized at the end of all invited speakers discussion. So we are getting questions in the chat boxes as well as we are getting in messages. I'll be moderating the questions at the end of all the four sessions.
Yeah.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you. Now our second speaker, Dr. Chunbia Lee. Professor Chunbia Lee, you can take over. You can present your ideas to the students. Welcome, doctor.
Hi, everyone. Can I share the screen?
Yeah, yes. You can, sir. You can, doctor. You can. Share full screen, doctor.
Yeah, okay. Screen.
When you're sharing, please share entire screen. Doctor? Dr. Lee? Dr. Lee? Oh my God. Sorry, we lost him. Maybe I'll invite the next speaker, Shri Jitu Mohan from Siemens. Sorry, Jitu Mohan, we have to prepone your talk because Dr. Chunbia Lee has lost his connection. You can take over and you can share your screen.
Okay. I think, first of all, thanks for Chennai Institute of Technology for inviting me for this. I'm really honored. Again, I'm really honored with sitting as a panelist here with Professor Mahajan and all others. Okay. Okay. Is my screen visible?
It is clear.
Okay. Thanks. Okay. So research as a career. So I will be here concentrating more on corporate R&D because, as I said, veterans are out there from the other institution, academia, and also from the government-funded institutions and the labs who can tell you more about the research in this particular areas also. Even research is similar in all these areas. How we target the research and what are the major aspects and maybe the skill sets of the things which is required is maybe slightly different. So I'll try to concentrate more on the corporate R&D. Interestingly, in this decade, there is a lot of opportunities for the corporate R&D. It is not like previous times when we have only sub jobs, which is not maybe related to R&D. If you have to do R&D, you have to definitely go with academics or maybe a government institution for R&D or institution, government funded R&D labs. So, but the thing is, there are a lot of challenges when it comes to corporate R&D. The main reason being, corporates are interested in business also. How you can convert this particular R&D into products and services, which we'll be able to sell and maybe make business out of it. This is also an important aspect that you have to keep in mind of. So the skill set towards this productization has to be more when it comes to R&D. So as Dr. Milan rightly said, the interdisciplinary research is very important. And also the time-bound research is also very important in corporate R&D. So as I told, there are positions which is very, very challenging, especially when it comes to research in corporate. Research positions will be very challenging because every year or every day you will have you have a new problem statement which you have to solve. It is unlike the other work where you can plan your daily or monthly work well in advance because since the problem statement or the skill set which is required for solving that particular problem will be similar. In corporate research, the problem statement will be diverse. But what is the advantage of solving these particular problems? It is actually a lot of impactful. That means the solutions that you are going to make out of this research that you are doing today, maybe on tomorrow you will be able to use, or your friend will be using, or maybe your relatives will be using that applications on the solutions or the products. And it will be creating a lot of value in the society also. So if you are a person who is enjoying these factors, the diversity in the topics or the impactfulness that particular solution or the product that you are building and the value you are more interested on the quantity of the work that you are doing, then you have to opt maybe a challenging opportunity in research and corporate. So I have put a poll in the chat maybe half an hour before. Maybe 65% of the people are interested in corporate research. But let me tell you, it is slightly challenging to pursue a career in the research in a corporate. But there are challenges. But once you have these keys or the skill set, then this is very interesting work to do. So what are the keys for maybe for pursuing a career in the corporate for the research? The first important skill is definitely the competency. Second is communication, research mindset, persistence, planning, and timelines. The competency is nothing but the core competency that you should have for solving a specific problem. For example, let's say if it is an artificial intelligence related work, definitely you should have a core competency in artificial intelligence. Or else if it's a mechatronics related work, you should have a mechatronics related background, and then you have to have core competency in that particular background also. So in general, nowadays, it is more, the projects are more becoming interdisciplinary. So unlike previous times where you have only one area of expertise, where you just concentrate on maybe for decades, here we may have to complement the area of your competency, core competency, with some additional elements also. For example, as a mechatronics engineer, I should know the mechatronics and the mechanical aspects of it, and also the electrical aspect of it. And when it comes to productizing any of the mechatronics projects, we should know how the control aspect of it also. So you build your core competency in your areas where you are interested in. Interest and competency has to go together. So many a times people choose a career or maybe a research career also thinking that, okay, this is very interesting to go with this because this is a booming topic now. But you have to think twice, because whether that particular topic is also interesting for you. So how do you find that particular factor, whether how it is will be interesting? Because it is very difficult to identify at maybe at an age of 20s to identify or make a decision. Interestingly, they said that at 20s, you make a lot of assumptions than the decisions in the assets. Because a lot of inputs from your colleagues and you will have a lot of mediums when the inputs are coming and you will be confused about which is my area of interest. So let me tell you a tip for that. On a Sunday afternoon, if you have 1 hour of time to read on a technical topic maybe or listen to a technical topic, the topics that you will be searching maybe in a YouTube on that particular time may be the area of interest that you will have. So if you are not getting bored about this particular topic and you are persistent about this particular topic for quite some time, then your area of interest is that. Identify that particular topic and start working on that and build your skills in this particular area. Second is research mindset. So as Dr. Millet rightly said, when it comes to a recruitment of a new employee, we are not looking forward for somebody who has actually invented a product as such. So those who will be able to refine some idea and those will be able to bring out some new things out of all these ideas using the fundamentals what they have. So when you start any of the research project, your mind will be this. There are a lot of ways which you can proceed with and you are confused about which ways you have to take. And then you, after a point of time, after experimenting or researching on that particular topic, you narrow down and finally you have the right solution for that particular problem statement that you're working on. So you should be persistent enough to reach this particular stage. And also your research mindset should complement this. So if you are in this and starting off your research, and if you are very confused about how to start and what you have to do, and if your research mindset is not there, you will end up in not even trying out that particular solution, one of the solution which is there in your mind, and then you drop that particular problem itself, which is not good as a researcher. So you have to go a little bit in detail in all the problem statement to see the finite elements in this and then connect with your core competency so that you can derive a solution out of this. This is very important aspect of when you pursue a research as a career. Another thing is very important in corporate research is communication and collaboration. So in classical mindset, many of the times we think that, okay, research is an individual contribution, but in a corporate sense, definitely it will not be an individual contributions, and a combination of multiple mindsets who is having expertise in different fields will come together and collaborate and bring in some solutions which will be converted into business. So on day-to-day basis, you should be able to communicate your research outcomes and also the research thought process and with your colleagues and collaborate with them to bring out. So again, interdisciplinary aspects come here also, because your core expertise may be in mechanical or civil, and you have to bring out a solution, maybe an intelligent solution out of this particular mechanical world. Then you have to communicate rightly with maybe a computer science guy or electrical guy who is going to derive or write programs for it, or maybe develop a driver for this particular solution that we are building. So in that case, you should be able to communicate with them, and there comes the elements which is required for apart from your core competency. So if you are not aware of any the other fields, if you are a mechanical guy and you don't know much about a computer science or electrical, then you may face a communication gap with the other colleagues who is sitting with you for solving this particular problem. So communication is important. So how you will be able to bring out your communication and collaboration skills? So when your professor is telling you to maybe present some of the topic, even in this COVID time, you will be getting some assignments to complete, maybe present something. Don't go behind and say that, okay, I will do it later. Communicate, right? To communicate what is your thought process. It need not be always so much impactful when it comes to your initial presentations. Once after maybe making 20 presentations, you will realize that how to make some presentation, how you can put together your content in a right way so that you will be able to communicate. And collaboration is actually a soft skill which you have to bring out, because now when you do a team project, you should be able to listen to some others' ideas and also work together so that your ideas is also integrated into the solution. So definitely if your ideas are good, definitely it will get integrated. But there is, assume that your colleague also having a similar idea and his or her idea is better for solving the similar problem. So you should be able to agile enough to adapt to that than sticking on to your particular solution that you think that is your baby. So that is very important. And don't keep that sticking towards your ideas or your problem statement when it comes to a collaborative mindset. So the emotional factors for your ideas has to be a little bit reduced when it comes to a collaboration. This is very important. And another important thing is timelines. So in research world, it is very difficult to define some timelines because you are not aware of what are the impediments which will be coming in the coming months when it comes to the products of this particular solution. If everything is defined and you are able to modularize it into time frames and stick it together and will be able to deliver, then that is not, may not be a research. That is an implementation that you are doing. So if the solution, you are not aware of how you are going to reach this particular solution, then maybe it is it may be research. It may be another way we can say that you don't aware of this particular solution. That is another case. That is a research. There is something called research approach, where you with the process you will be solving this particular, whether it is only that I feel that this particular solution is difficult, or everybody is also feeling that collaboration mindset is also required. So you discuss and present it multiple forums so that your idea is unique and your solution or your thought process is actually unique. But timelines are important. When it comes to, you don't know what is going to happen maybe in the coming months, and you will not be able to put the right timelines many of the times. But you put the timelines, tentative timelines, and try to present your outcomes. May not be completely the results which is actually usable results. Maybe that your failure will also be an outcome, which is actually you have to present many of the times in front of the crowd. So you should be confident enough to present this. I have tried out these particular things and I am not able to bring out this solution for this at the end of this particular month. You should be confident enough to do that also, because in research many of the times this happens. If, as I told you, if everything is everything rightly you plan and you execute, then that is may not be a research at all. Okay, so when your professor may be telling you to stick on to the timeline of a submission, try to do that, because that is some soft skill that you are learning, or a transferable skill that you are learning in this process of education. Okay, another important thing is persistence and smartness. So as I told you, in research mindset, persistence is very important. So let's say you are thinking about a research problem now, and you are thinking that, okay, overnight I'm going to bring out some particular solutions which is going to change the world in one day. It may not happen always, right? You may have to persistently work on that particular problem, maybe hours together, to realize that, okay, this particular solution is going to, this is how you build that particular solution, or this is how, in this way, if you are solving this particular solution, will be much helpful, or this, or even you solve that. So initial part of your research will go on for identifying or formulating that particular problem statement itself, and then you work on that, and then you derive your results out of it. So you are able to persistently work on that particular problem for hours is very, very important. It is not like, okay, this week I am taking this particular problem statement, working on something, on next day you are going to go with something entirely different at all. But persist on this main topics. Persistence doesn't mean that you don't explore also. You majorly concentrate on one particular topic, but don't leave your exploration mindset away. Just keep exploring, but keep in mind that your majority, maybe 60 or 70% of the time that you're going to spend on the main problem statement that you're solving, other 30% will go for exploration on maybe for other topics and all. Persistence is very important. So very important thing which I'm seeing many of the interviews from the young minds is actually the freshers who is coming for the interview, they don't have persistence. So we cannot actually build the persistence in you. This is something you have to bring out yourself, right? For example, time boundness, we will be able to train you over a period of time, but not about persistence. Persistence is something that you have to yourself find out how you will be able to persist on this. And smartness also. Smartness is something that, okay, I worked on this particular topic for maybe for a few hours and I realized, oh, this is very important. And next month I'm realizing, okay, there exists a solution for that also. You should be smart enough to adapt that particular solution towards your goal and then stitch it together. This is the smartness part of it. It is not like emotionally connected to what you were solving, the maybe some classical approach that you have tried and maybe interestingly new approach in the literature is available. You should be smart enough to adapt that, okay, and also definitely value that also. Say that, okay, this is, I have got from this particular material or the research paper. Very, very important thing which I'm seeing many of the times people don't concentrate is transferable skills. Transferable skills are that you learn over a period of time. Whenever you, these skills are transferred, can be one project to another. For example, best practices or competence in some particular areas or the soft skills that you have got. This can be transferred from one project to another. So whether you work on a research project or maybe a development project or academic project for maybe for creating a seminar or maybe creating PPT itself will be some transferable skills that you have got, right? Because you have, when you present something towards to the others, your research outcome should be presented in a way that that person also should be understandable. Maybe your boss is not from an entirely different area and you should be able to narrate in the way that he or she will be understanding that. This is something that transferable skills, which you should concentrate at early stage itself. So this is very important when it comes to life of a researcher, how the transferable skills that you are keeping or how you are improving. And very important thing is identifying where you are lacking. Many of the times people don't realize that you are lacking in some specific area and then go ahead thinking that you are the best. Okay. So this is the this is very important. So many of the forums where you like meetups or the hackathons will make you realize where do you stand in many of these things, and then you will be able to improve. And this is applicable for core competency also, and also the soft skills. The skill set, whether you really have that skill set or not, you have to be very careful on that. That means you have to talk to your maybe fellow colleagues quite often, or maybe go to a forum and discuss on your project, so that you will be able to identify the skill set which maybe you are lacking. Maybe some other top transferable skills, but I'll go to very important thing or the perception. So this is a perception. When you join as a early researcher in any of the corporate institute, you will have this particular problem of new versus pro. As a newbie, you have got some skill set. As a pro who is working maybe for 20 years in this particular field, or 10 or 20 years, 25 years in this particular, they have their veterans in this particular topic. So many of times we waste our time in comparing your noob skill set with the pro skill set which they have acquired for along maybe for in decades. Okay, for example, the timeline related skills or persistent related skills, you may not be able to even compare the persistence of a maybe 20-year experience guy when you join as a newbie. But you have got some skill set, some thinking thought process. You have got new thought process because you are not biased with many of the technologies that was existing in previous decade. So which is actually an advantage. So never think that, okay, I have made some particular research problem statement, formulated, worked on for maybe few months on that, and then I have brought out some results. And this is not much valued because already pro has worked on maybe for a few hours on that, he is able to bring out the similar results. it may be true in many of the cases, because that is why he or she is called as a pro. Okay, but this perception is you have to remove from your mind when you are an early researcher. You should be confident about your delta change or delta improvement that you are bringing into the research, and should be able to confidently say that, okay, this is the things which I have brought in. Maybe that other person will be able to solve this maybe quite easily, may not be also, but you should not worry about that. So the perception of being yourself is very, very important when it comes to research field. Now, coming to planning, this may be my last slide. So now you will be in the undergraduate and you will be thinking about how do I plan. This planning is very, very important for out your researcher in your view. First of all, you do an top-down planning. Top-down planning in the sense where exactly you want to be, which exact area of research you want to do, and then plan your steps towards that. So let's want to be a researcher. First, you should have is an interest. So this I brought out by thinking from here, the top researcher, and what are the main areas which I will work or concentrate on, then I will realize to become a researcher. So interest is very important, because if you have to have this persistence, there should be some motivating factor which is actually doing that for years. So your interest. And once you find your interest, improve your skills. There are a lot of now, interestingly, the information or the knowledge is more democratized in the particular decade. You have a lot of online materials available, and if you have interest, nobody can stop you from learning about that particular technology, because you have options for that. There are MOOCs like CIT, Udemy, or the materials in the YouTube. It's a YouTube lectures or the forums. You have lot many places to explore. Only thing is that you have to choose the right ones. Okay. Now you improve your skill set. Dirty your hands. Do hands-on, because you have this particular knowledge, and without hands-on, it is not necessary. The researcher will always do hands-on, and from the experience you are going to learn. Do hands-on. One hands-on with the off-the-shelf problem statement when it comes to maybe skill development. There are a lot of off-the-shelf problem statements. For example, code hosting platforms or the project hosting platforms where you can actually learn this. Okay, now you bring in your project now. You formulate a project and you should be able to be confident that, okay, I'm going to persistently work on this topic for another few months on this. And share your results. Intermittently share your results in the meetups, on participate in hackathon, maybe in the meetups, internal meetups that is in your organization, your institute, or maybe an external meetups, and try to share it. So many people don't share this information, see that, okay, my project may be unique and I don't want to share it. But that should not be the case, because if you have thought about it, definitely that there will be somebody else who thought about it. It's about the matter that not in each other. So uniqueness in the implementation will be there, or IT which is coming implemented in a different ways will be there. But there will be also may have thought about this in many of the time. Share this. Worry about somebody is actually stealing your ideas. Definitely share this. And you bring out the research project, formulate your research project. Initially, you have a project, okay, you have some deliverables or you have some demonstrators on there, and you bring in research elements where you are adding your delta into it, which is a unique contribution from your side. So with the interactions, you will be able to know where exactly the gap is, maybe from your literature survey also brings you that particular element, where exactly gap is existing. And once you have outcomes on it, publish can be many forums. Maybe you can publish as a conference paper, or if it's a unique idea, you can patent it also, or there are different forums to publish. Now, once you publish and you be able to confidently go to many organizations and... If you get an opportunity in the project itself as a researcher or research intern, grab that. But consistently work on this particular areas also. Then publication is very important. So many of the students comes and tell that, okay, I am not seeing many research opportunities. Then I say one thing, you don't need many research opportunities, you need only one for you, right? That is mindset that you should have when it goes to research or research opportunities in corporate. So you have to have a picture, and many of the times in when you grab this particular opportunity, you may not see this particular opportunity in the platforms or LinkedIn published for all. Maybe it is available only at the career website of that particular organization. So once you improve yourself, so work on the listing the companies who is actually working on this particular area, so anything R&D in this particular areas, that is very important. And the geography also, many of the times, many of the organization will have the R&D centers is distributed around. So, but you have to plan in that case for studies in that particular area, so maybe traveling abroad also is possible for a researcher, because you, the times you have to travel to other countries or pursue your research opportunities also. Yeah, but in India, it's a lot of opportunity are actually available. So once your research internship is have grad, then it is only about showcasing your skill set or maybe skill set to the employer, right? Because once you are here for maybe for a couple of months, and you should be, the employer will be able to see the value that you are bringing in. Then maybe 20 minutes or 1 hour interval where you are actually working on yourself or you are being interviewed, right? So this actually gives a lot of opportunity for you to interact and also learn from the researchers, fellow researchers, so that you will be able to mold yourself as a researcher. Then you become a researcher. By the way, you interesting thing about researcher is whenever you are first year also, or maybe after 25 year also, myself as a researcher. Or the lead or expert or something, that is actually the tag the company gave me. I call myself as a researcher. So it is about how you are happy yourself in connecting with your interest and pursuing the topics that is out of your interest. That is very important. That is what you are going to do from there onwards once you So I hope I was able to help you with some thought or maybe a line that you can actually pursue, become a researcher. And definitely I'll be interested to receive your questions from your side also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jidu. It was interesting, and we have got many questions for you, but I'll be compiling all this at the end of all the four speaker sessions. Thank you, Jidu. And let's welcome Professor Lee.
Sorry, just some...
No issues, Doctor.
Yeah,
Doctor, are you ready with the presentation? You can share the screen.
Okay. Can you see? Is it normal?
Yeah, if you share the entire screen, Doctor.
Yeah. Hello,
yes,
everyone.
Perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Hello, everyone. Today, we will discuss something about research. I'm Chen Biao from Nanjing University of Information Science and Technology. Yeah, I will discuss here three issues. First, why do we research? The second, how can we make a satisfying achievement? And the third one is research as a career. Why do we research? For me, I think we can consider the three items: interest, contribute, and self-realization. Interest. In fact, learning the reason and learn what is happening is our nature. For us, it is time to research learning the world. We have love. Tool, method, data, equipment to study the real world, which has been regarded linearly for a long time. The era of nonlinear research has come. Reductionism based on linear hypothesis has turned to be nonlinear analysis based on complex system theory. Furthermore, theories get merged together, nonlinear dynamic equation, stochastic resonance and weak singular detection, chaos coexistence, and something like that get emerged together. And the tools grow in their own passages, C language, MATLAB, Python, and other tools. So here is a game. Let's make sentences with the word I love. I love a good environment. What kind of and how can we do? I like delicious food. What kind of and how can we do? I love good reputation. What kind of and how can we do? I love good friendship. What kind of and how can we do? I love all kinds of efficient tools. What kind of and how can we do? All these questions, if we use the word I love, we find that we can find why we do, we should do some research, and we will invent. And by research, we can make our mind to do some research for our interest. The second one, why we do some research, is to contribute to the times and the society. As said by our president, Xi, here actually it is a time of community of common destiny for all mankind, and the unity of self-value and social value actually in this time combined together. Anything occupied by a person is paid for its effort. For example, with his wisdom, his strength, and sometimes even his life. So we do research work, just try to contribute to the times and the society. So also, let's do a game. Let's make sentences with the word because of you. I get good and clothing because of you. I live in good building because of you. I get excellent. All this is because of you. So it is time for us to make our mind, to make the world better. Let's do some research for you and our society. How can we make a satisfying achievement in our field? Here, we are discussing three items: grasping basic knowledge and exploration tool. The second, RAP, to start our research. The third one is increase our passion and solidify our achievement experience through output. Grasping basic knowledge and exploration tool. This is a basic idea for us to do a research work. Learn some knowledge, but not limited by this. Learn some exploration tool, but not limited by this. I think these two ideas is very important. Sometimes we feel that knowledge is boundless and the exploration tool is boundless, but how can we start? So we just low end for learning and boundless energy, but we can turn back for innovation. We just want to learn how to learn, learn how to research, learn how to apply a tool to help you get something new and something alone found by you. Expression tools. Here in our area, usually MATLAB, Python, MATSIM, PSPICE are necessary for us to make our progress in research. The second one I want to say, how to start your research. For an undergraduate student or graduate student, the very important question is that, how can we start our research? Here, I give you three steps. I combine these three steps just as wrap. Here, R means reading, A means asking, and P means practicing. reading. As you know, before we study a research, the first thing is reading, including reading papers from the same topic or the same group, reading books with the same topic, reading doctoral thesis or project proposal. By reading these materials, we get information from discussion shown in maybe our further on conference or some other website. So here I give you one suggestion. Reading is a source of new ideas. So read one paper per week. I think it is necessary. For some people, maybe we need more papers in 1 week. Just as said by Francis Bacon, reading enriches people. Talks make people agile. Writing and notes make one accurate. Historical records make one wise. Poetry make people smart. Mathematics make people fine. And natural resources make people deep. Ethics make people solemn. And logic and rhetoric make people eloquent. Here I will give another suggestion. Believe everything in books is worse than to have no books at all. Actually, if we believe the idea from this book and from that book and from all the books, we find that they actually do not agree each other. And also, maybe we have some difficulty to start our research, because we don't know how to begin our research. So if you want to believe everything, it is terrible. The third one is I want to say when you read a paper, actually you need a lot, read the paper or the book from the beginning to the end. Actually, we just want to take some message home. Maybe we should think what is the important thing in this paper or in this book that we can see this in the abstract, the conclusion, or in the introduction. The second thing I want to say, begin a research. Usually will lead to ask. This is the second step. Once you try to ask, you begin breathe in research. Ask, how to ask? You can say, how if, what then? One, add one, and then. Delete one, and then. Make bigger or smarter. Change in a direction. So I will give a question, give a suggestion. One paper, one question at least. Sometimes we need to ask more questions according to the description in a paper or in a book. If you give the question, we can study from the question because you know we can try to answer this question, and we by this means we can collect our materials to do this thing. Here I will give you another suggestion. Usually, comprehensive cognition comes from local cognition. You know, if you want to draw an elephant, you know, actually the elephant is so huge, you cannot get the global view of this elephant. Maybe we by feel or touch the skin, the leg, the nose, the tail. So maybe we think that the elephant is like a snake, is like a wall, is like a fan. So you will say that our cognition is not comprehensive, is not comprehensive. So we need more methods to do more research on even a small subject. So just let asking surround you. In our group, we study chaos, study memoristic circuit, study neural networks. So we can ask many, many questions. What is chaotic oscillation? How make the chaotic oscillation more easy to control? Can we generate a chaos oscillation by a simple memoristic circuit? Yeah. How can we apply chaos in engineering application? All these questions can start our research. The last word is practice. Practice. You can do real experiment or data simulation or circuit and engineering simulation. Sometimes we need to link together and compare with theory analysis, check together with each other. How to practice? How to practice? Just as say in this slide, do some experiment, do more simulation, do more analysis. All this is just, yeah, all this is just practice. Actually simulation, sorry, can you see me and hear me?
We can hear, doctor.
Oh, yeah, yeah. It's okay. It's okay.
Yeah, we are waiting for the presentation. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Oh, yeah. So here I wanted to say simulation and experiment are good media to verify ideas. Try to see something by practicing. Actually, practicing can promote theory, and the theory should be revised by practicing. Practicing is a beginning of knowledge. The third one I wanted to say, increase our passion and solidify our achievement experiments through output. You know, if we have not do some experiment, we have lot idea to be tested. We have lot papers published. Sometimes we are confused that what are we doing? What should I do? Actually, we can increase our passion by do experiment, by writing papers, by writing apply or patents. Then how to increase our passion? Here give some suggestions. Usually we put ourselves in a team can give us strengths. There is a easy saying go that if mosquitoes assault together, elephants will be conquered. And actually torches light torches. Here is another way to solidify our achievement experience through output, appealing to heart flow. Heart flow is a theory proposed by Mihaly. Heart flow has the following characteristics: activities that tend to be engaged in, focus on consistent activities with clear goals. They are immediate feedback activities. I have a sense of control over this activity. Our anxiety disappears when we engage in activities. Subjective sense of time changes. For example, there is a sense of time flies. So we can get verification of subjective beauty from objective manifestation. In fact, we can test our idea in mind by subjective experiment, so that we can increase our confidence to the research. To be proactive, I got some data from the website that thousands of scientists publish a paper every 5 days. It means that 1 year, 22 papers, just like our greatest scientist, Regopo. He is also a productive scientist. Why some researchers are so productive? Here is some list for our reference. Hard work, love of research, mentorship of every many young researchers, leadership of a research team, or even of many teams, extensive collaboration, working on multiple research areas or in core service, availability of suitable intensive resource and data, culmination of a large project, personal values such as curiosity and sharing, experience growing up and sleeping only a few hours per day. So where to go with us? Our group study nonlinear systems and its application in engineering, specifically including chaos, memory, resistive circuit, and neural network in artificial intelligence. The last issue I want to say, maybe it's time to make our mind to make research as a career. How to do this? Consume our energy and capacity and connecting our effort. I think this is the first suggestion. Output a blueprint for making the world better. And the last one, increase our spirit, contribution, and personal value. Consume our energy and capacity and connecting our effort. You know, in China, many easy goons below the heaven and the people actually together producing, creating, making self-satisfaction, just like a person with the nature be as a whole, as a whole. Here, I will say, our greatest Kobe. Here is a location map of all 30,699 students in Kobe's 20 years career. He says, you cannot possibly become better than me because you are not spending the time on it that I do. If you want to spend the time, you can't because you have other things, you have other responsibilities that are taking you away from it. So I always won. Another sentence from him that the most important thing is you must put everybody on notice that you are here and you are for real. I'm not a player that is just going to come and go. I'm not a player that is going to make an all-star team one time, two times. I'm here to be an all-time great. Once I made that commitment and said I want to be one of the greatest ever, then the game became everything for me. So the second suggestion, I think, output blueprint for making the world better. Actually, in university as a student, whoever graduate student or graduate student, we need to try to write something, apply apply something. Here is two way for us to do. One is write papers and the other is write patents. Actually, by write papers, we can get our idea proved by theory, verified by experiment. And when we arrange all these materials together, we can make them be a paper and submit to a journal and make it published. Also, when we create a new idea, we can apply the patents. So preserve our idea, not be used freely. Yeah. Here in our group, we do some research work on learning dynamics. Actually, I always tell my students that scientific research is just like tourism. It is to observe the new phenomenon in new space and think about its regularity. Yeah. Here, all these Chinese characters just mean that we research on chaos, fractional order, dynamic systems, memoristic systems, and some issues from this research. And the last one, I will say, increase your spirit, contribution, and personal value. Just as said by Einstein, a person's value depends on what he contributes rather than what he gains. If you want to contribute,
I think we lost Dr. Gaurav Rao also. We had a problem. He is having a park idea in this area. I don't know whether he will come back. We are trying to recover his presentation so that he can use his phone to. But I don't know how far he can come back.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see whether. Dr. Tubia Lee will rejoin. In the meantime, I have the panel questions for. First, I'll go on with Dr. Milind Mahajan. We have some questions, Doc. The first one is you have been throwing lights on many opportunities in ISRO. Some students want to know what are the opportunities for a finally, as students to have some internships or some long-time attachments with ISRO agents.
Okay, that's a good question. What the ISRO provides from their final year students through their head of the department can approach to the HR department of different ISRO centers wherever they would like to work, and then normally. 4 months time frame is 4 to 5 months time frame. If they can come on the campus and work with a particular scientist in that field, and they can complete their project. This is one project activity during that the internship. The ISRO provides an opportunity. If you ask the long term beyond the research, for example, now this COVID pandemic has improved, given and opened up a new. Arena wherein now the students can collaborate and even work continue even after the submission of their project, because now entire thing is through either online media, so they are continuing their interaction and still work on that, except for the and the guides are kind enough to even they can come after the submission of project, they can work in the lab for a short duration and still can carry out the work. So that kind of work, though it is not formal, but it is being done from this last year and this year onward, because that has pandemic has really given opportunity early. So they can continue their research after submission of project also. So this is for grad students. And for postgraduate students, they can continue, even they can stay on campus for even 1 year duration and carry out their research.
Thank you, Doctor. The second question is, if a student is taking such kind of internships in ISRO for even a PG student or an undergraduate student, will they be having some uppercut while recruiting? For example, you have been mentioning about recruitment.
No.
Okay. And the next question is, Doctor, we have been hearing about ISRO giving project funds to some student projects in some institutions. So is it open to all institutions or it is restricted to?
Yes. The RESPOND project, that is called Sponsored Research, is open to all projects. In fact, we do make sure that it is distributed geographically over entire India. Our entire country. It is not, we are not biased to the specific high institution like IIT. There are some few IITs we do have a separate cells, that is, they are called STC, Space Technological Cells. They are installed, they are working from the few IIT, core IIT. But the sponsored research program is open to all institutions over the entire area. And they can approach, they can submit a proposal, and then accordingly after evaluation and then interaction and few iterations, they will normally they get the fund.
Thank you, Doctor. And one more question. See, the Doctor, you have been mentioning about the final year projects being done in ISRO, where the students can directly apply through the HR department. But is there any opportunity for short-term internship for the first or second year students?
In fact, that currently it is not there, because what we have found in our interaction, even in the 4 months or 2 months time frame, they spend nearly most of the time in understanding the working style and work and adjusting to the environment, and the time is over. So normally first year or second year time, a student, they get only 2 months time frame, and that we found it is not really the useful. And the organization normally gives the training. It's a win-win situation where the organization also gets from the student and students also learn. So 2 months time frame, we believe it is a short time frame. So it is not encouraged currently in ISRO, but however, 4 months and more time frame is certainly encouraged.
Thank you, Doctor. And the last question is, we have been hearing about some ISRO institution, they jointly launched Pico satellites. Small satellites. Yeah. So, is it also open to any institution who are interested in such activities?
Yes. ISRO, in fact, ISRO is not going jointly. It is the institute by themselves are developing their own thing, and they want, wherever they want advice or they want expert opinion, expert, they approach the ISRO. There is a separate cell in ISRO, ISRO headquarters, and they make all the facilitates, all the expert guidance to them. And they build their own. They can, ISRO provides the facility in case that they are required. ISRO provides at no cost, and then they can build a satellite and launch through our own launch vehicle. There is no biases, it is open to all.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank you for these are the questions the student posted. Dr. Lee joined us. Welcome back, Doctor. I think we lost you for.
Website chop off. Sorry.
Thank you, Doctor.
I don't know where I disconnected.
No issues, Doctor. So, if the presentation is over, can we go for the question posted by the students? You have some slides to present further?
I don't know where I.
No issues, Doctor. Doctor. So, let's go to the questions. We have some questions posted by the students for you to clarify.
Okay. Yeah.
The first question is, what are the opportunities for research and development students in China? For example, if a student from India wants to have a post-graduation or a PhD in China, for example, under your artificial intelligence, what are the prospects? Are they eligible, or what are the criteria you look into?
Yeah, actually, in China, there is a scholarship from the government. If somebody in your country wants to study with us, you can apply from the website. International funding scholarship. I don't know, but you can check on the website. you can find this way to apply. I think so.
Yeah.
And also, if you need some personal assistance, you can just email me. Yeah.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you. And the next question is, there are some students who work with, for example, in our Center for Nonlinear System. We have a Center for Nonlinear System. We have some undergraduate students working with us. Is there a way they can spend a short time with your lab or your expertise or your students visiting China on a student exchange program? What is the possibility of such exchanges, doctor?
You mean Nonlinear System?
Yeah, for example, Center for Nonlinear Systems to your center or to your lab. If our students want to visit your lab on a short duration for a month or so, working under you, what is the exchange possibility?
Yeah, okay. Yes, actually, we do some research work on Nonlinear Circuit to do research work on chaos, to find the chaos in Nonlinear Circuit by many different methods. If you want to do some experiment, you can cooperate with us. Actually, we can do some experiment for you. Yeah, to check our theoretical funding or something like that. Yeah, we can go together. Yeah, cooperate. Yeah, we can cooperate together. Yeah.
Thank you, doctor. Thank you. These are the questions posted to you, doctor. Thank you. Let me go on to our next speaker. That is Shri Jidu Mohan.
Okay.
The first question is, you spoke about the importance of research mindset.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So you mean to say that it is about the research temperament, research persistence, or a generic research mindset word? This is a question posted by one of our students.
Okay. So one thing which I've tried to tell you is actually on the persistent side. This is also part of the research mindset. And the second part is actually on going a little bit more in depth on this particular field. That is going into the finite elements of this particular, when you are looking into a product or a project or maybe a solution or maybe a service also. That you are building, you have to go a little bit more into the finite elements of it so that you will be able to bring out something which is solving some particular problem statement inside that. That means a unique problem you are bringing out from that itself. That is a research mindset. For example, as a corporate researcher, you will be called for consultancy in your business. Business units are the are actually your arms of your organization who is actually working hard for you to implement and then produce the services and products. So when you go there, you should be you will be your finite looking skills into these products and services to bring out some delta improvement on this is what they are looking into. So this is very important. When in the undergraduate itself, we are actually having this particular mindset, it will be helpful. For example, let's say we are having project the talks from the your colleagues. So many of the times, we will not be too much interested going finer deeps into what they have done and what is that they have implemented on. So you have to have that mindset that you explore that also. So you are, it is not related with your project, but you still explore on what is that technology it is they have implemented. What can be improved? What are the finite elements which is actually critical in that particular system? This is actually a research mindset which an undergraduate can actually practice on. And then it'll be very helpful on this. Yeah.
Thank you, Jidu. The next question is, you have been mentioning about sharing the research ideas in meetups or hackathons.
Mm-hmm.
But you know about the, we are not still strong enough about the IPR rights or, the patents are still in very early stages in India. And the most of the student ideas are they have been leverages where you have been having some trouble. What about preserving or protecting the ideas and then sharing? So you have any idea of protecting and sharing?
Yeah. So when it comes to the protecting your ideas, definitely you have to shed out some amount for that also. if you are in a part of an organization, definitely organization will help you in that. And definitely they will be sharing your IP also. That means owner of your IP or intellectual property or the patent will be your organization. So I have, when I worked in Bosch, I have filed patents. I have an, I am the inventor, but owner of the inventor will be my organization. So you can also individually patent also. When you are in academics also, you can will be able to do it. But there is actually some elements to it. So one important thing is you can directly walk into any of these patenting consultancies, which actually helps you to do this patenting. So one important thing is that how much worth is there there for your idea? You have to have that particular thought process in there. And second part is whether this particular idea is helpful for next 20 years. For example, and completely out of the box idea, which is actually maybe coming in after 20 years, your patenting rights will be valid only for 20 years. So there is no point in patenting at that particular time. In organization, that will be classified as trade secrets, and we will preserve that, and we will be patenting at particular time. So we have a separate, any of the research organization will have this patenting department also, who will be connected with you and quite frequently. At least once in a month, they will have the detailed review of the project that you are doing so that the intellectual property will be, they will be able to pick it from you. And another important thing is it is not, it is always about sharing also. Because many of the time, people think that their idea is unique. But you will realize after some time that after your thorough literature survey that it is already, there is some elements already been there. So my professor always tells me this. So if you are not able to find 5 research papers which is related to your particular area of research, you are either doing a completely out of the box thing or maybe that it is completely outdated or something that is not implementable or realizable. That is what you are looking into. Otherwise, maybe third reason is that your research is actually not proper also. So I think especially in academic institutions, I like that particular mindset when it comes to literature survey. Professors actually gives ample time for the students to do the literature survey before starting their research project, whether it is a short-term or long-term research project. So this is very important when you do it. But you are right, when if you are somebody is actually feeling that they actually have valued their idea, they should go ahead and patent it. That will actually add a lot of value. And students has actually done also, many of the colleagues whom I have actually with them, they have already patented at the time when they are in academics also. And companies actually values that also a lot. And why I told about the conference and the journal publications is companies values that also a lot. Now, the academics, if you are saying that you have done project, either you should have a publication on it, or else you have a hosted code on that, or else you should have maybe some hackathon you have participated or somewhere these elements of implementations or your work is already there. That is a third party recording your particular work that is actually should be there. Because that actually increases the authenticity of what you are actually telling. So than just telling I have been experiencing, I have been doing this for maybe past maybe couple of months or 3 months here. I can say that I have been working on this and I have a publication also on that. So that actually adds a huge value in that. And any research internship, if you have a publication, we take ample time to go through your presentation before coming for the interview. So if you don't count on the number of publications on that, but just count on the quality of the publication that it may be only one conference paper or a journal paper that you're doing. But that quality actually brings out what is the research or research mindset or research potential in you. Okay, this is very important.
Thank you, Jiti. As you mentioned about the publications and patents, the final question is, how do you recruit researchers for your team? For example, if you want a researcher, do you go through a regular procedure of, you know, like technical interview or something, or you will consider the publication part of the student or research aspect of a student and consider it?
Interestingly, we have different routes for different research levels. We can say that a mid-research level, early research level, that means an internship or intern and then coming as a researcher, or a mid or maybe higher levels also. So we, since we are more interested on the early research career, I will maybe talk on that. So there are some institutions where we have MOU from where we definitely consider the students for the internship, research internship specifically. But what I generally do is I posted my LinkedIn page so that I will be able to get some students who is half of the students at least actually from entirely different. So I have a couple of students who is not having any MOU with our organization in the previous year. I have recruited through this particular process. So this is something which we do. So that is very important. So because let's say you are doing a mechatronics research or something, you can get connected with the people who is in this particular area. So their community postings you are aware of, and then apply for it and then do it. So first part is actually getting an interview call for a research in, research organization. That is very important. And definitely the other part, when you directly connect through the HR also, they really consider your resume. Many of the times your students say that we didn't get any call or we didn't get updated. So assume that you see from, I mean, my case itself, I have got around 100 applications in a couple of days after posting that. So I am doing this, and if HR is doing this every day, it is very difficult. Maybe they will be getting thousands of applications, and they might have kept some criteria for recruitment. So that is the initial criteria. Many of the students' resume will just bounce in that particular criteria itself, because either it is not right fit. Fit is very important, or you are not represented your skill set or in the right way also. That may be reason. May not be the you are not from this specific institution that we are actually not considering. That scenario is actually not there. Now, because I remember that time there was National Institutes also, the students were there whom I have selected is one of the students is not from any IITs or NITs, but what I look forward is actually for the research mindset, not from the pedigree from the institution which they are actually bringing in at all. And second part is actually that once you are getting an interview, the second part is actually how you get through the interview. There comes the elements which is already your persistence bringing in. Persistently, you are working on a project and you will be very confident about that particular project. That adds a lot of value. It is not with a few questions that we actually recruit the employees. So we give a problem statement. We tell the students to solve that particular problem statement. It need not be a programming type problem statement, because programming is something which we can actually teach you. There are a lot of training materials and rigorous training, and maybe in a few weeks you will be able to program. But logic is something, or the research approach is something which we cannot teach you in a research organization, because it will take long time. So if you already have this experience, it will be very easy for you to, with your basics of knowledge or the fundamentals, you will be able to solve that problem statements and you will be able to recruit. So the experience has maybe in a hackathon or maybe in a meetups and all, where this particular process will be happening quite rigorously, will actually help you to clear this particular interview levels. And as Dr. Mahajan, Milan Mahajan has rightly said, none of the research institutions will actually recruit you for maybe for an invention that only for that particular invention that you have said. And done, or maybe for a cutting edge research that you are actually doing or pursuing, or the colorfulness of the topics that you are working on. It is all about how thorough you are on the basics and the fundamentals. And it is very difficult to do that, because you have to read a lot, and then only you will be able to get expertise on the fundamentals. So at early stage itself, if you feel that you are good at fundamentals, again, you may not be too on that. You have to revisit that by maybe going into a practice of discussing with somebody who is your guide or your professor. Then analyze on your fundamentals itself. and work on that particular areas, which actually helps you on this. So I think I was able to help you. I was a little bit long on this. Yeah.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Let me thank all the speakers for sparing their time, enlightening our students on various research aspects. Thank you, Jitu. Thank you, Dr. Milind Mahajan. Thank you, Professor Chinbi Ali. Unfortunately, we lost Dr. Gautam Rao because there was a power failure in his CTN. So we apologize for that. And with this, we wind off the session. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Have a pleasant day. Thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Thank you, Professor Lee. Thank you, Milind, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Goodbye. Thank you.